warfare comprised four main German machines, supplemented by two tanks manufactured by the Czech manufacturer Skoda.
The Panzer I and the Panzer II were mainly used as reconnaissance vehicles. The Panzer I had a two-man crew, driver and a commander, and was armed with two 7.92 machine guns. The Panzer II had a three-man crew and was armed with a 20mm automatic cannon. The Panzer III and the Panzer IV were much larger tanks. They had a five-man crew, which was normally a driver and a gunner in the hull, and then a gunner, commander and loader in the turret. The Panzer III was mainly used as a fighting tank. The Panzer IV was used more as a support tank with its 75mm gun. But the interesting thing is that after the fall of France in 1940, the Americans decided that if the German tank, the Panzer IV, had a 75mm gun, then that would have to be the minimum size of the gun that was used in the Sherman tank. So it was actually the Panzer IV which led to the development of the guns in the American tanks during the Second World War.
The first of the new German tanks was the tiny Panzer I. It had its roots in the turretless tractor developed in secret between the wars. It weighed just less than 6 tons and had a crew of two. Machine guns provided the armament. The main armor protection was provided by 13mm thick steel. Although its limitations were exposed in Poland, this vehicle was used extensively during the campaign in the West. The Panzer I was designed as little more than an armoured machine gun carrier, and as such, did not present a great threat to enemy armoured machines.
As you can see, it's not a very tall vehicle. I'm not particularly tall when I come up to head height on the thing. It's very lightly armoured and very flimsy, but in 1939, this was the kind of vehicle you would face, and in 1940 these were the machines that swamped France and took part in that lightning campaign.
It was basically a training vehicle to get used to a tank for the different drivers who would have to drive the heavier and bigger tanks. And they were quickly built. They had ordinary engines in it, nothing special, and were not very fast either.
The Panzer II was designed to run alongside the Panzer I and provided a tank with armor-piercing capabilities. The first models weighed in at just less than 8 tons, with later models increasing their weight to just over 10 tons. This vehicle had a crew of three. One MG-34 machine gun and one 20mm gun provided the armament. The armor protection ranged from 13mm in the Model A to 30mm in the Model H. The Panzer II was a very reliable tank and had a top speed of 35 miles per hour. Like the Panzer I, this tank was effectively obsolete even at the start of the war. It lacked sufficient armor protection, and the 20mm cannon was not effective against the Allied tanks. The Panzer II was to be used as a reconnaissance vehicle, but found itself in the thick of the fighting, performing the role of a battle tank.
The Panzer II is equipped with a 20mm automatic weapon, which will pump out rounds at a fairly steady rate. Next to it, a typical German machine gun, MG-34, with a very, very high rate of fire. That's it. The other thing I would point out, which I think is relevant, is that German tanks, even from almost the outbreak of war, were a welded construction. And the difference this makes cannot be overemphasized. It means that the tank is integrally much stronger, that it doesn't have a subframe to add weight, and in addition to that, it's pretty well watertight.
The Panzer III was classed as a medium tank by the Germans, but by the standards of the day, it was still fairly light. The weight of the Panzer IIIs used in the Western campaigns varied around 20 tons. It was crewed by 5 men. All of the Panzer IIIs that saw action in the Western campaign of 1940 had a 37mm cannon as their main armament. This was backed up with 3 MG-34 machine guns. Two were placed in the turret at each side of the main gun, and the third was situated in the front of the hull. This tank had 30mm armor protection and a top speed around 25 miles per hour. However, the main problem was the 37mm cannon. It was a poor match against the heavier armor of the Allied machines. The decision to fit the early Panzer IIIs with the 37mm gun had angered Guderian, who had forcefully argued that the Panzer III needed a main armament of at least 50mm caliber if the shells would have any realistic chance of piercing the heavy armour of the British and French tanks of the war. Later Model Gs were fitted with the better 50mm main gun, but were too late for their inclusion in the Western campaign.
The Mark III only came out because the development of what was later known as the Panzer IV took very much longer as anticipated. And so they brought this Panzer III out, which was a smaller version of it in a way, and performed excellently in France. But in retrospect, it wasn't all that much better than, say, several of the British or even French tanks.
In addition to the Panzer III, the German Panzer Division also included an infantry support tank. These early Panzer IVs had the low-velocity, short-muzzle, 75mm main gun. This was backed up with two MG-34 machine guns. One was situated in the turret, and the other in the front of the hull. Armour protection ranged from 15mm to 30mm. The speed was the same as the Panzer III at 25 miles per hour. This tank was a good design, although the versions used in this stage of the war had the low-velocity L-24 gun, which was only designed to fire high-explosive shells and lacked the real hitting power which was needed for tank-to-tank contact. Nonetheless, once it was upgraded, it was to become the main battle tank of the German forces throughout the war.
This is an early war version of the Panzer IV, which was the infantry support tank which was used by the German forces early in the war and through into the desert campaign. You can tell it's the early version by the extended commander's cupola up on the top there, which looks almost like a dustbin that's been stuck on the tank. As you can appreciate, this wasn't a particularly good innovation because in action it represented an easy target, and they were frequently ripped off by enemy artillery, which left the tank vulnerable. So by 1941, these had begun to disappear. Round at the front, we see the 75mm infantry support gun. It wasn't a high velocity gun, so it didn't give it the kind of tank killing power which it needed in the Russian campaign, but certainly for the early desert years, it was more than adequate. We can see here the thickness of the armour. By this stage in the war, it's about 40mm thick, and it would get progressively thicker as the campaign wore on. One of the ways to upgrade the Panzer IV was to add on extra spaced plates in front of the turret, which gave it a lot of extra strength. Again, some uncompromisingly flat armour at the front here, and as tank design improved over the war years, they soon realised that what you need is sloped armour that deflects shells away from the vehicle. So this was very much a wrong design in tank terms, but those lessons still had to be learned and still had to be assimilated.
When the Germans annexed the regions of Bohemia and Moravia in early 1939, they took possession of the main battle tanks of the Czech army at the manufacturing plants. These machines were incorporated into the Germans' existing lineup of tanks. They consisted of two designs. The 35T weighed in at 10 tons and had a crew of four. It was armed with a 37mm L-40 main gun, which was very accurate, together with two 7.92mm machine guns. The armour protection was 35mm thick, which was very adequate for a light tank. The engine produced a top speed of 25 miles per hour. The second Czech design used by the Germans was the 38T. It weighed less than the 35T at 9.5 tons. It also had a crew of four. Its main armament was a 37mm gun backed up with two machine guns. The armour protection was 30mm thick. It had a top speed of 26 miles per hour. Unlike the 35T, this machine was renowned for its reliability and ease of maintenance. These two light tanks made a very valuable addition to the range of tanks already available to the Germans. It has been argued that without these two machines, Germany would have been unable to conduct the offensive in the West.
The 35T by 1940 was quite an old tank. So it was phased out after 1940. But the 38T was a very successful tank used by the Germans very successfully in the fall of France.
it was capable.